Welcome back to Science in Real Life. We're at the Arnold Arboretum of Harvard University. An arboretum in the broad sense is a botanical garden of trees, but we're here today to find out what makes the Arnold Arboretum so special, both as a center of scientific research and as a community resource. Super special guests to facilitate our Arboretum adventures today. This is Ned Friedman. He's the director of the Arnold Arboretum and a professor of organismic and evolutionary biology at Harvard University.
Hello.
And this is Kristel Schoonderwoerd. She's a PhD candidate in Ned's lab. Hi.
The Arnold Arboretum is the oldest public arboretum in North America. It was born in 1872 of an extraordinary process which brought this into Harvard University's collections of natural history. It's also a part of the city park system here in Boston. It was designed by Frederick Law Olmsted, who designed Central Park in New York City. It's an extraordinary collection of over 2,100 species of woody plants from around the world. There are 15,000 individual organisms that we keep track of here, and we're standing under one of our really beautiful trees here, a sand pear collected by one of our early collectors in China, Ernest Henry Wilson, in 1908. And for over 100 years, it's been sitting right here, growing and flowering to the delight of many who come to the Arnold Arboretum.
So every one of the 15,000 trees has its own personal story. Would you like to go and meet another one?
Yes.
When you walk by a tree at the Arboretum, you might think,
that's a good looking tree. I want to meet that tree.
And it turns out you can.
Hello.
In fact, you can know this tree's entire life story.
And that's because each woody plant at the Arboretum has a tag that contains all of its information.
This tag shows the story of this particular paperbark maple. It shows its common name, its Latin name, Acergrisium, the family that it's in, the Sapindaceae, that it was collected by E.H. Wilson in China in 1907, and that it came to the Arboretum as a plant. PT is our code for plant.
And this number up here is the tree's accession number. This is a unique identifier for every single individual at the Arboretum, and it's linked to a database on the Arboretum website that contains all of this individual's history, its collection information, and also links to a map so you can find your favorite accession when you visit the Arboretum. So that means that everyone can know the story of every single tree here. And throughout the episode, we've included the name and accession number of each tree we talk about. So if you're ever at the Arboretum, you can visit the same tree as we did.
Living collections contain several species of trees which have become rare in the wild, and making the Arboretum important for conservation. About 7% of our holdings are threatened in the wild or even extinct. And a good example of that is the Franklinia altamaha, which is native to the state of Georgia, but hasn't been observed in the wild since 1803.
What?
Thanks to plant collection, it lives on in botanical gardens around the world, making sure that we can still observe its biology every day. And today's actually a special day because the Franklinia has just opened its first flowers of the season.
Oh my goodness. That is so magical.
So this is an amazing tree behind us, but it's not only meant to be looked at, they're meant to be studied for scientific purposes. We have a huge research building here, and it's filled with graduate students, undergraduates, professors from around the world, and they come here because we have these extraordinary organisms, and they do research here.
Well, Kristel is an excellent example of a scientist who's using their living collections in her dissertation research. Shall we go say hi to your trees?
Yeah, let's do it.
See you in a bit, Ned.
Okay, see you.
So I used the collections for my dissertation research on the development of resting buds.
Resting buds? Is that like a bud that's napping?
Yes, resting buds are essentially small packages of immature leaves ready-made for next spring. Now, most people might think of buds as a sign of spring, but resting buds are actually there pretty much all year round. Most temperate trees start making resting buds in the summer. That's almost a year before the immature leaves will leaf out and start getting ready for photosynthesis.
Wait, so these guys have to survive the entire winter?
Yes, they're there in the summer, in the fall, in the winter, and they have to deal with all of the environmental variation during that time. This is a problem that most temperate tree species face. And interestingly, a number of different bud shapes and protective features have evolved to deal with this same kind of problem. So buds can be protected by hairs, by resins and gums and other nasty chemicals. And lots of temperate trees make specialized leaves around the outside of the buds which we call scale leaves or butt scales, and they look very different from the foliage leaves.
Yeah, I can see that. So all these little pointy guys are the bud scales.
Yes, they're just there for what we presume is the protection, and they will fall away in the spring
and reveal all these big, beautiful leaves. So.
But not all temperate trees make scale leaves, and for my dissertation, I want to try and find out why. So the really cool thing about the Arboretum is that you can use all the different trees to study the variation in shape. Nowhere else in the world can you find a shellbark hickory from Missouri, which is very prominent scale leaves, growing right next to the Hubei wingnut from central China, which is in the same family as the shellbark hickory, but its buds don't have any scale leaves.
Wait, so that's a bud?
Yes. Each of these little structures right here is going to turn into a fully sized photosynthetic leaf next spring.
No, wait, wait. So this little guy is going to become this big guy and survive the winter?
Yes, absolutely.
But how does it do that if it doesn't have any of the protection features that we were talking about before?
So the honest answer to that is we don't actually know. And this is part of what I'm trying to figure out for my dissertation. I collect these buds all throughout the year and look at them with microscopes and micro-CT scanning to find out what's going inside this little bud. Hey, we're back.
Welcome back. Welcome back. You found me at one of my favorite trees in the Arnold Arboretum. As a public park, as a public botanical garden, we serve as much more than just a research institution or a group of plants to be studied. Unlike many cultural institutions and many botanical gardens, by definition, we are free and open to every single person. Really, what changes is if you have no barriers, anyone can come, from someone who has nothing to someone who has everything. So social justice and the idea of outreach and educational opportunity for all is really built into the very DNA of this institution. This is where a very democratic sort of set of ideals of how plants should be shared with the world come to be. So it's a really magical place. And again, it comes back to it's not just trees, it's trees and people that make this magic.
Well, Ned and Kristel, thank you so much for sharing that magic with us today. This was incredible. Be sure to visit the Arboretum if you're ever in Boston. And of course, links to the Arboretum website, the Friedman Lab website, and their social media channels are all in the description. And please subscribe to Science in Real Life for some more magical science experiences. See you next time. This episode was brought to you by the American Society of Plant Biologists and the European Society for Evolutionary Biology.